I plead the blood, oh Jesus. love coming in here. I love worshiping God with everybody. I just love it because God is so awesome, and we just take the time to think how good He is. We forget it because we don't see Him. That doesn't mean He's not doing the things that we need Him to do. He's always in the background when He is working. He's moving. He's healing. He's delivering. He's saving. Even though we pray and we don't see the prayers being answered right away, He's working it out for them. He's working it out for them. He's working it out for them. I'm so thankful. God is so good to me. He is so good to me.
Why would He send
people like him. And if we are set apart, if we're peculiar, if we're chosen, whatever, God, I want to be like you, Jesus. Brother Calvin, he's done too much for me. He's done too much for me. I want to be like you. I want my husband saved. I want my son saved. I want my grandchildren saved. I want my great-grandbaby saved. I want my cousins. I talked to a cousin today online, the other day online, that I knew she probably blocked me. And I told her, I said, we had a praying grandma. And I gave her some scriptures. I said, I just love you.
Yeah.
I can't help it, I love you. And Grandma Ellen prayed for us. She prayed for us, Charlotte. She prayed for us, Sue. I just told him. I said, but you know Robin, that's how I am. But I want to see y'all make it. I want to see us go into the kingdom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. To be in the kingdom. But oh my God, I'm so thankful, Sister Rita. Just like you. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful. I can't help it. I'm so thankful. He's been so good. But yes, saints, what else can we do? Once you've touched this, what else can you do? Nothing else satisfies.
Hallelujah. Oh, can't turn.
the place that will produce the kingdom of God. And I'm so grateful. I am so grateful. That message we heard this morning was so powerful. It's so timely. We all know about what has gone on in the city and all that mess. Do you know the Lord spoke to me and I knew this, but God just confirmed in my spirit. He said, because they had said, you know, there was some folks there with Bibles and all that, which that was fine. That's what they thought they needed to do, you know, whatever. But God said the greatest weapon God's people have against the culture is to be faithful to the work of God. To pour everything they have into the work of God. Be steadfast in work, what God's called us.
That's right. Yes.
We can go down there, march up down the street for days and days, and somebody would notice, not necessarily that they would take heed to what we said. Maybe they would. But if we can build a church.
Yes.
If we can, we are. God has blessed us. I was so grateful for that message this morning.
Amen.
It's only one. But my grandchildren need to hear that. My little Addison Grace, she needs that really badly. Her dad's been real concerned because she gets very defensive when you start talking about it. She's 13 years old.
Yeah,
she's 13 years old. Where'd she get that mess?
Come on.
You know where she got it? She got it in our secular school system. And you know what? If our children, or if we, do not have the Word of God to measure that up against, to measure against that mess, we have no defense.
That's it.
We absolutely have no defense. We have to tell it. We have to talk about it. And, you know, God is so gracious. He's so wonderful, and He does love us. This Rita, and He didn't have to, but He does.
Yes, He does.
And I don't want to even get into Tommy's testimony, because sooner or later, one day soon, I'm sure he's gonna tell you. God's really working in his heart. For the last probably 6 weeks or longer, I've had more intimate discussions about God and the Word of God and the things of God with that young man, 42 years old, that I've had in his whole adult life.
Amen. My God.
Sit for hours and talk about either on the phone or at my kitchen table or wherever at the house when he comes to talk to me. I never knew how to get that. I never knew how to get to that with him. I couldn't do it. But trouble.
Yes.
Come
trouble. Brought him to it. And you know, sometimes through the hardest times of your life, and the you can see your children go through just pure hell. I mean, it is. Life is anyway, especially without the Lord. But to hear your child say, "Mom, I've run from God for 30 years. I can't do it." You know why he knew he couldn't do it? Because when he was a child, there was something instilled in him. In a school, in a church. Why would I not support the school? Why would I not support the church? My son is saying to me, "Mom, I've run for 30 years. I can't do it anymore." He said, "I know I'm a child of God. Now I have to accept that that's what I am."
I just want to say,
look at the scriptures and what God says about that, that how he's God and how he changes not, and how he wants us to be holy and how he wants us to be like him.
Yes.
And listen, you know, and just the nonsense is coming out there that, you know, I was actually talking to a person online and like, oh, God is love and this and that. And he goes, you know, I just pointed them to 1 Corinthians 6:9-11. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived.
Amen.
Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. For you were washed, you were sanctified, by the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the Spirit of God. And I look back over my life, and I think, God, I have probably been at least all of those things at some point in my life. But God, in his mercy and his goodness and in his grace, saw fit to continually pursue me. As many times as I rejected God, as I walked away from God, as I declared that I wasn't going to serve him, in the hardness of my heart, he did not have to pursue me, but he did. And I just wanted to put this out over live stream. If you think that you can't change, you're right. You don't have the power to change on your own.
Right.
But I know a God who can break every chain. I know a God who can deliver you from the deepest hole in Jordan. I know a God who can break every stronghold and deliver you from every sexual perversion. You don't have to walk in that. You don't have to live that. You do not have to allow that to be your identity. But you can be a child of God. There is a power that's out there that's greater than the Lord of God. Sometimes
is running. There is a difference in hearing preachers preach and hearing the word preached. It doesn't take very many people to be able to take a few verses and make it say something.
Right.
But it takes somebody anointed to take that same word,
right.
Put it down into your spirit until it does something,
yes.
Until it changes you.
Yes.
And we will not preach a powerless gospel here.
No.
I will not preach that people can't overcome their sin.
Right.
I will not preach that people are forever going to be failures.
Right.
The devil is a liar.
Yeah.
If I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loved me, then how can I always be being conquered? At some point, the table has to turn. And I cannot be the conquered. I have to become the conqueror. And you can go to many places and they will inspire you in your sin. They will make you apathetic in your sin. Listen, if you're in sin tonight, and I mean in sin, in deliberate, willful sin, and you don't feel the conviction of the Holy Ghost, you need to come to this altar and you need to cry out and say, God, please let me touch you again. Because I'm telling you, there's no way you can be in an atmosphere like this and not feel the convicting power of the Holy Ghost. Saints, we weren't meant for shallow water. If they want shallow water, let them go wade in it. I've got waters to swim in around here. I've got waters that go over my head around here. And there's no way a child of God who is deeply rooted in the Word of God can be satisfied with shallow. There is no way. It is impossible. But when you don't care about the Word of God and what you care about is relationships, it will be easy for you to leave the Word over relationships. But that's not what God called us to. He didn't call me to leave the Word for relationships. He called me to leave relationships for the Word. That's how this thing works. He called me to walk away from people and from situations and circumstances that continue to hinder my walk with God so that I can walk with Him. And it's an issue of control. I'm going to tell you something. It's an issue of control. There are people, the reason why I don't like this church is because they can't control. They can't control the word.
Right.
They can't control the preacher.
Right.
They can't control.
Right.
And when they know they're not where they want to be, they want control.
Right.
And so they'll go to a church that has ankle deep water. People say, you're putting off on churches. No, I'm not putting off on churches, because the real church has the power to change people.
Right.
So if there's churches in this area that are really powerfully changing people, and I'm not talking about teaching them how to do church while they leave them sinning. I'm talking about people who will go to church and be a child of God at church and then go home and be a child of God at home. That's what I'm talking about. But people will leave an atmosphere like this and they'll leave teaching like we get here to walk in ankle deep water because they can control that water. They can control the flow of it. It only goes so far on them. It doesn't overtake them. They're able to keep their footing in that water. And they're able to stay strong in that water and keep themselves upright in that water. But when you come into a place where there's waters to swim in, when you come into a place where the water is over your head, you can't control that anymore. Now it begins to control you. The word begins to control who you are. It begins to control how you think. It begins to control where you go. It begins to control what you do. The reason why people don't want to be in churches like this is because they want to sin and still come and call themselves a saint. But the devil is a liar. You can't be a slave to sin and a servant of God at the same time. And I think all these pastors around here, let people come in like that. Let them work in their churches like that. I pray God sits every one of them down. Because we're not helping the people while we leave them in a state of being slaves to sin when the power of the gospel is there to break every chain, to destroy every yoke. Come on, somebody. I'm not okay with people living churches in this area letting people off on talent. They're letting them off on talent. They're looking past their sin on talent. I was watching a video today of a church in our region where there was a young man playing the piano, and the Lord spoke to me and said he's fornicating. I wonder if that pastor knows that. I didn't just come up with that. That's what the whole, and I guarantee you 100% that's what's going on. Where are the pastors that can call out the people when they're in sin private? The church that I came out of, you couldn't just walk into that church and be just any way you wanted to be, because the Holy Ghost would call you out. I hope you're hearing what I'm saying. Some prayerful saint of God would come up to you and expose you for exactly who you are. And it would cause conviction to fall on the people till they ran to the altar and said, oh God, change me, forgive me, turn me around. That's what this church has got to do. I don't care how talented people are. They can preach better than me. They can speak so well that they can preach me up under a table. But I'm telling you right now, if their life is not right, if their life is not holy, if their life is not sanctified, God, reveal it. God, show it. Because I don't want them to be, listen, it's a trap of the enemy to be able to come into the church and be able to perform and go home and sin. It is a trap of the enemy because it causes you to become apathetic, because the church is supposed to be the place where judgment begins. It's supposed to begin the house of God. That's where this thing starts, is in the house of God. If I don't come in here and feel judged of my sin, then I will go home and become apathetic in my sin. Once I become apathetic in my sin, I will be lost. Because I will feel like if the preacher doesn't know, if the saints don't know, then I'm okay. But God knows. More than the preacher, God knows. More than the saints, God knows. If God knows, I don't care how much you fool the preacher. I don't care how much you fool the saints. When you stand before that great white throne, you ain't fooling nobody. He's going to open your record and he... Bishop T. Patterson sings the song and says, oh, my record will be there, be its pages dark or fair. When I stand before that great judgment throne, when the books shall open wide in that morning, by and by, oh my record, it will be there.
Amen.
It doesn't matter whether it's bright or dark. My record is going to be there. And what we hide to the preacher is going to be open before everybody. Everybody standing before the great white throne is going to know. But if you get it under the blood now, then when you go before Jesus, he will not be confessing your sin before the people. He will be confessing your name before the Father. If you can get it right now, God in heaven. Loneliness is a powerful tool of the enemy. It destroys people's confidence. It destroys them.
It does.
They think, well, I'm alone. And if I'm alone, nobody cares.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so we begin to be manipulated by loneliness. We begin to sit there and say, God, you know I need this, and I need this, and somehow there's a disconnect here. God is never disconnected.
Right.
Everybody say that with me. God is never disconnected. He's never disconnected. God is never, ever wrong. And God, somebody said, I found the Lord. You didn't find nobody.
No.
Because God was never lost.
Right.
The Lord found you.
Because
right. You were lost.
Right.
God is never lost.
Right.
God is never in a place
no.
where he needs anything from you.
Right.
So if the relationship between God and me is he is the supplier of my need and I am the recipient of his of his blessings.
Right.
If there is a disconnect, it's not on God.
Right.
Right.
Ever.
Mm-hmm.
Never.
Never.
If there is a disconnect, it's on me. One of the messages that Brother Williams he preached when we were in his church, I will never, it was plug it in, plug it in, plug it in, you know, after the and he was talking about being plugged into the power, because God is never without power.
Right.
Right.
If there is a lack of power, it's not on God's part.
Right.
Right.
There is a disconnect in me.
Right.
Because he said, now I'm just giving you his word,
mm-hmm.
that if you seek first the kingdom of God and his
righteousness.
And his what?
Righteousness.
His righteousness. Then all these things shall be added. What God is doing in your life and my life right now is he's desiring to reconnect us to the place he had us where he could use us to the capacity that he desired. So I must be reconnected. You must be reconnected. We must get plugged back in. You will never do that in a place where they teach you you're always connected. You will never do that in a place where they teach you that no matter what you do, the love of God is always going to be there to meet you. You will never get that. You will never get it in a place where they don't teach holiness. I'm not talking about outward dress. I'm talking about inward activity, inward character. You will never get that. And you will never go to a church that is inspirational and make it into the first resurrection. You are going to have to go to a church that is revelational. That's where it's going to put you in the first resurrection. And I want to remind you something, saints. We got a kingdom to gain. We have a kingdom to gain. That kingdom does not come by a welfare mentality of entitlement. That somehow because I am, he's going to give it to me. He said to them that overcome. Everybody say overcome. To them that overcome will I grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. To them that overcome will I give to them the crown of life. To them that overcome will I give them power over the nations. To them that overcome will I give them a new name.
Amen.
Good Lord in heaven, help us. I want to overcome. To them that overcome will I grant to be a pillar in the house of my God. I want to overcome, saints. I am not a victim. Somebody say I'm not a victim. I'm talking about it. Say it till you believe it. I am not a victim. I refuse to spend my life as a victim. I respect God. Some of y'all carry your own personal chalk around you to make your body outline every time somebody asks you how you are. But I am not a victim. At the cross, I became victorious. I am no longer the person that I used to be, because my being a victim was not to the hand of anyone but myself.
Yeah,
but they did it. Why were you there? Most of the time we're hurt by people. It's people that God told us not to be around in the first place.
Amen.
I'm telling you what the truth is.
Yeah.
It's relationships we know we should have had in the first place.
Amen.
Because relationships that start off in sin normally end in destruction.
Amen.
Well,
say
God,
that. Say that.
It is never God's will for his children to start anything off in iniquity. It is his will for us to repent and then do it his way.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Oh God. Saints of God, I've got a future.
Yeah.
If all you have is a past, then that's all you have. But I don't have just a past. In fact, I don't even have a past any longer. The Lord purchased that for himself. I do not have a past. All I have is a future. And if you want to live in your past, live in your past. If you always want to be the victim, be the victim. But I am no longer a victim. I am no longer a slave. I am no longer a servant to this world. I have become a child of the living God. I am now a servant of Christ. I am not a victim. I am more than a conqueror. I am victorious. I am called of God, anointed of God. I've got the Holy Ghost. I got the blood of Jesus. I got the name of Jesus. You can be whatever you want. I intend to be what God's called me to be. Which means that fornication cannot be named among us. Adultery cannot be named among us. Theft cannot be named among us. Hatred cannot be named among us. And just because I preach against sin doesn't mean I hate people. Come on, somebody. I can hate sin and love sinners. The reason why I'm preaching against sin is because I love them. The reason why preachers won't preach against sin is because they love themselves. Come on, somebody. Because when you preach the truth, you're going to get hated on. You're going to get people talk about you, criticize you, all kinds of stuff. But you have to love the people more than you love you in order to really see people come into the kingdom of God. So I want to say this. This, what God's doing in this church right now, is a tremendous work. And it goes beyond a building, but it includes a building. What God is doing right now is deeper. It's deeper. And the reason why some of us can't get away from it is because we're not tired of swimming. We saw what happened when we were in control. But now we're seeing the benefit of what happens when he's in control. I want the Lord to be in control. Because when the Lord is in control, he changes me. When the Lord is in control, I can say goodbye to those things that used to bind me. When the Lord is in control, the chain truly gets broken. When the Lord is in control, the yoke truly gets destroyed. Are you hearing what I'm saying, saints of God? When the Lord is in control, he won't let you fool nobody. When the Lord is in control, he'll expose you for who you are. That's what happens when the Lord is in control. And all of that will bring about a child of God who is ready to enter the kingdom of God. People tell me, they say, you talk too much about the first resurrection. I don't think I talk enough about it. Because that's the goal. That would be like a coach saying, we've talked enough about scoring touchdowns. That's ridiculous, isn't it? Yeah, we're just going to settle on field goals. Tennessee, Tennessee does. We're just going to settle on field goals. We talk too much about scoring touchdowns. You know what? I'm going to spend the next 2 or 3 months here, and I'm never going to utter the word touchdown. He would be fired. If the goal is the first resurrection, then the first resurrection is what we got to talk about. I don't need every service, but I may say first resurrection every service because I don't want you to lose sight of the goal. The goal is not to live your best life. The goal is not to do you. The goal is not for somehow to give you 7 principles of how to live economically prosperous. The goal is the first resurrection. Now here's the benefit. If I seek first his kingdom, the first resurrection, and his righteousness, then all the things everybody's focused on will be added to me in the... Come on, somebody. We're talking about economic prosperity. I'm talking about the kingdom. Because if you put yourself in the kingdom, if you get yourself in the righteousness of God, then all these things. This is where we're headed as a church. This is the vision of this house. We're going to see people saved. We're going to see people filled with the Holy Ghost. We're going to see people baptized in the name of Jesus. Then we're going to see them being prepared for the first resurrection. That's the goal. That's the goal, Brother Brian. I don't have any other reason to preach. I don't have any other reason to be here. If it was just to preach you a message to get you happy, I have no reason to be here. If it was just to preach you until you run all over this place, I don't have any reason to be here. Because if you can't get happy over the kingdom, there's something wrong with you.
Yeah.
If you can't get happy over the first resurrection, you need to pray through.
Right.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? If that gets you bored or uncomfortable, there's a spirit in you that needs to be cast out. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of spirits crying out over the word of God. I told you that this morning. When Jesus came into that synagogue and he began to preach the word of God with authority, all of a sudden a man who had kept quiet the whole time. While all the other preachers were preaching, he kept his mouth shut. Because there wasn't no power there. But when you get into a church where there's some power behind the word, then spirits start crying out. I don't think he ain't got no right to talk about my situation. He ain't got no right to come after me like that. He ain't got no right to say that stuff. I'm sick of hearing about that. Doctrine, 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 doctrine. I'm telling you, that's a spirit. That's a demonic power in your life. And it needs to be cast out and cut away from your life. Because if you can't get happy over the word, there's a spirit in you. There's a spirit crying out.
Hallelujah.
Woo, hallelujah. I'm telling you, God's going to expose some spirits around here. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If people are hearing this over live stream, and you go to this church, and there's something you say, God, there he goes with doctrine again. Come out in the name of Jesus. There's a spirit in you. Because what did the man with the spirit say?
Leave us alone.
Leave us alone.
My God.
Just don't. Because whatever Jesus was saying was dealing with them. Can you imagine? We know he was 30 years old when he entered that synagogue. So for at least 30 years, these spirits had sat in the church and never got dealt with. Spirits, demonic powers, sitting in churches.
Yes, sir.
Never being dealt with.
Right, brother.
Because there's no power.
Mm-hmm.
Spirits of perversion.
Yes, sir.
Spirits of laziness.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
Right.
Spirits of gossip and backbiting.
Right.
Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Spirits of hatred. Spirits of bitterness.
Yes, sir.
Spirits of addiction.
Right.
Sitting in churches. Coming to church every Sunday and never saying a word. But when somebody with an anointing walked in the house, all of a sudden, leave us alone. Let us be. We like it here. Just leave us be. We know who you are. Leave us alone. But Jesus said, shut your mouth and come out. He wouldn't even permit it to speak. We know that thou art the Holy One of God. And Jesus said, shut up. Come out. This is the kind of power I'm talking about.
Yes.
Are you ready for that kind of power? Are you ready for that apostolic anointing? Because it has been on my life my whole life. I had a preacher tell me the other day, they said, you know why these preachers are going after you like they are? I said, why? He said, because you will say what needs to be said and they can't stand it. It's exactly what he told me. There is an anointing on this ministry to see chains broken. And these spirits are either going to be cast out or they're going to run out. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm not going to sit and play games because, Brother Joe, we don't have time to play games. You go into a prison every week dealing with those same spirits. But let me tell you something. Just because people are not behind iron bars don't mean they're not in bondage. Don't mean they're not in prison. And if they come into the church every week and they can go home and act like hell, act like a child of hell, but they can come into church and lift their hands and praise God, and those spirits never ever are disrupted in them, then that is not a church. That is a playhouse. That is an entertainment hall for the morally obligated. But God has to have some churches in the Tri-City area that when the word of God begin to go forth, people start shaking and reeling on the inside. That's when we'll have an awakening. That's when things will begin to happen. And if that word doesn't satisfy you, it's because I'm not a preacher or you're not a hearer. At some point, the preached word has to become the focal point of the church again. Because that's the only thing going to save us. That's the only thing going to deliver us. That's the only thing going to break the yoke off of us. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. It is time for it. I am counseling with some young people now in this area. They need this church. They need it. And the enemy is doing everything in his power to hinder them, and they're doing everything in their power to let him. But if they'll get in this church, they will become the people of God that God called them to be. Every gift of operation in their life is going to explode out of them, and the chains, I'm telling you, listen to me, the chains that have been binding you, they will come off in the name of Jesus. That yoke will be destroyed. I didn't come all the way here to play games, saints. We didn't buy a building to create a fun house. We bought a building to create a house of prayer. From our Father's house shall be called a house of prayer. Glory to God. Come out, children of God. It is not over. The power of God has not left. It's still here. Get out of your sealed houses. Come out of your prisons. The doors are open. The chains are broken. This generation needs to encounter this power. They need to run smack dab into an anointing that hits them right in the face. Because when you see yourself, after you've looked at everybody else, and you blamed everybody else for the way your life is, and you blamed everybody else for the misery you're going through, at some point you come out of the cycle. Because most people suffer in cycles. Yeah. Hurricane, put your name on it. Because you're just sitting there spinning. And destruction is in your path.
Yes, sir.
Over and over again. Maybe different people, maybe different places, but it's the same problem. And we're satisfied to suffer in our cycles. I'm not satisfied to watch them. I am not satisfied to watch them. It's time for them to come out of their cycles. And it's time for them to become children of God. Because here's what's happening. They're forfeiting every good thing that God has for them. And the longer they wait, the more they forfeit. The longer they wait, the more they forfeit. Wait some more. Forfeit some more. There are many young people in my generation and younger that God could have used so powerfully by now. But they keep forfeiting it in cycles. Maybe if I get the right man this time, it'll answer all my problems. Maybe if I get the right woman this time, it'll answer all my problems. It'll answer nothing. Because there's only one answer. His name is Jesus. Woo, hallelujah. And when you get Jesus, when you surrender to Jesus, you ain't gonna look for nobody else. In fact, you'll find them not looking for him. That's what we're building here. But what it's gonna take is a church that prays.
That's right.
It's gonna take people interceding. It's gonna take people turning off their television and putting down their tablet. And going, Lord, you know that you've called us into this place for this time. He didn't call us to sit here and sustain. He said, occupy till I come. The word occupy does not have a connotation that you think it is. It means just sit and wait. The word occupy in the Greek there, it literally means to overtake as an army. When we went into Iraq, guess what we did? We occupied it. When we went into Afghanistan, guess what we did? We occupied it. You know what we had to do before we could occupy Iraq? We had to conquer the enemy. We had to defeat the army. When we went into Afghanistan, the only way we could occupy it is to push back the Afghan rebels.
Right.
Push them back. The only way for this church to occupy this area is for us to get into a posture of battle. And the posture of battle for a child of God is not on their feet. It starts on our knees. Oh, glory to God.
Yes, sir.
Oh, glory to God.
Yes.
And this people is a powerful people. Because we not only have the Holy Ghost, but we have experience.
Yes, sir.
And there's something about people that have an experience with God.
Yes.
Or experiences. There's power in those people's prayer.
Yes, sir.
Because they know if God did it before, he'd do it again.
Yes. Amen.
New Destiny, it's time for us to get in our posture of war.
Yes.
It's time for us to hit our knees before the Lord. And instead of us spending all of our time distracted by things that really have no eternal value, in fact, the eternal ramification of them is hindering. That's what they do. They hinder.
Mm-hmm.
We need to turn all that off in our life and get on our face before God and get real with the Lord. Because we got young people out here that are in bondage.
Yes.
They are literally a half a step from coming out of that thing. We're going to pray them the rest of the way
yes,
out.
Yes, yes, yes. Amen.
Amen.
I got some mothers in here that have given birth. But even if you as a mother, you as a woman have never given birth, you understand naturally inside of you. If you were pregnant, you would know how to give birth. Because God put it inside of you. And a woman doesn't just lay there and say, well, if it comes out, it comes out. If it's delivered, it's delivered. Whatever. But before that baby is ever born, naturally, that mother has already fallen in love with it. So then when it comes time for that mother to birth that child, and birthing is not easy. It takes time, effort, and dedication. It takes pain. I don't know how much pain. But when I hurt my knee, my doctor said, because you can't have childbirth, which means that what I experienced was not even as much as childbirth. So God bless your hearts, every one of you. But he said, because you have not experienced childbirth, you've experienced the most pain a man can feel. But there comes a point, sisters, and I want to talk to you sisters right now. You're going to have to mother a generation. And you're going to have to bring forth a generation. You're going to have to bring it forth. Because they're in the birth canal right now. And there's a struggle. And they're having a hard time coming out. There's a breach somewhere.
Yes, there is.
But I need some mothers in this church
yes.
that can fall in love with a generation before they ever see it.
Amen.
I don't know if y'all are hearing what I'm saying.
Hallelujah.
You love that baby before you ever see it.
Yes.
And that means when things get hard in birth, you keep pushing. Not for your sake, because you know if you don't, that thing that you've never seen that you fell in love with will die. And so you're fighting for it before you ever see it. I wonder if I got any mothers in here that will fight for this generation, that will love this generation. And their love for this generation will be so profound that they'll fight for them before they see them. I wonder if we have some mothers in Israel that still know how to push until babies are born, until the child comes forth. I wonder if we have any mothers in here that will say, I don't know you, but I love you enough to birth you. I don't know you, but I love you enough to bring you forth. I may not even know your name, but I'm going to pray for you. I may not know. You're going to watch young people in a generation walk into this church and you'll say, I didn't know them. I've never seen them, but I prayed for them. That's one of those babies I pushed out. I'm telling you, mamas, it's time for you to get into the birthing position. And the birthing position is on your knees. It's time for you to get on your knees before the Lord and say, Lord, I don't know them, but I love them. And there's a fight going on right now. There's a breach in the womb. And this generation's having a hard time coming out. But God, we're going to stay here. And we're going to push. And we're going to push. And we're going to push until the baby comes forth. I believe that we have women in this church that will get together and say, we're going to push until they come forth.
Yes, Lord.
Praise God.
kids that are hooked into pornography. Pray, sisters, for our daughters that are hooked into pornography. Pray, sisters, for our brothers that think they can't survive without a woman. For our sisters that think they can't survive without a man. Pray, brothers and sisters, for a generation that is addicted on drugs, that is addicted on technology, that the spirit of addiction has overcome. There's a breach right now going on, but this baby's going to come forth in the name of Jesus. We're going to push until this church is full of people and young people who are calling on the name of the Lord. And I want to talk to you, brothers. You men of valor. You may not feel like it, but you are. If you feel weak, he is strong. Hallelujah. And his strength is made perfect in your weakness. You men who have not given up. You men who have not succumbed to the temptation to stay at home and watch football instead of being in the house of God, lifting up the name of the Lord. You men who have not succumbed to the temptation to be out hunting, but you're in the house of God today, praising the name of the Lord. You're fighting the culture of masculinity in this generation. You're fighting that temptation to be so strong that God can't touch you. To be so masculine and powerful that you cannot be emotional. You're fighting that because you're men of valor. Listen, when David called those men, when he went into that cave Adullam, they were broke, they were bankrupted, they were hurting, they were bruised, they were abused, they were distraught. But by the time they left the cave, they were mighty men. Because they had a leader who was a mighty man. They had a leader that stood in the face of opposition and just kept moving forward. He picked his fights when he had to, and he called on the name of the Lord the whole time. Let me tell you something, men of God. These sisters need men that will pray protection over them. These sisters need men that won't come in and cross their arms and sit quietly while the women worship. They need men who will stand up as men of God. My God, where is your war cry? If you were in battle, you wouldn't go in. You would go in, we're coming. You would shout into the battle. That's not my personality. I didn't ask your personality. I asked for you to do what the Lord has called you to do. Cry aloud and spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Amen. What does that mean? Yeah. What does it mean to lift up your voice like a trumpet? Sister Lenny, where are you at? Blow this trumpet. I want to see how quiet this thing is in here. I want to see how mealy mouthed this thing is in here. Just blow, sister. Blow that trumpet. Labor, and we're don't see this as a weekly event. This is not our routine. This is our life. This is what we're living for. I want to see them come out, saints. There are people I know out there that I love. They're in bondage. Some of them in church is in bondage right now. And if God doesn't give them a revelation, they're in more trouble than those that are out sinning and never attending the church. They're in more danger. But we serve a God who is able. We serve a God who is more than able. Wake them up, Jesus. Woo! Wake them up, God. Wake them out of their sleep. Shake them out of their slumber. Lord, awake them to righteousness that they might sin not. Oh, God, do it. It's my prayer, saints. Are we ready to be that church? I agree with Rita. We got so much to be thankful for. God didn't have to, but he did. Oh, God. Woo! He didn't have to spare us, but he did. He didn't have to make a way for us, but he did. He didn't have to save this work, but he did. He didn't have to bring us up out of the pit, but he did. He did, saints. I'm telling you, this is a miracle. This church is a miracle. This building is a miracle. You're a miracle. The fact that you're here is a miracle. I'm telling you, this whole building is full of miracles. This ground is covered in miracles. God has done wondrously among us. God has done mighty things, and this is the Lord's doing, and it is absolutely phenomenal, saints. It is wonderful. It is miraculous because he made a way for us.
Hallelujah.
And we're going to preach the messages of a savior, not satisfying. We're going to preach messages that will pull them out, not pacify them. Oh, Jesus, let it be. We are going to see young people saved. I don't care what people say. They say it's over for them. We'll just let them grow old and we'll go after their children. The devil is a liar. There is more hope for a live dog than a dead lion. As long as there is breath in their body, there is hope for their soul. I don't care what they're facing right now. I don't care what temptation is before them. They are going to be saved in the name of Jesus. They're going to be delivered in the name of Jesus. The yoke is going to be destroyed over them in the name of Jesus. The chain is going to be broken over them in the name of Jesus. The prison door is going to be opened for them in the name of Jesus. And this church is going to arise, and we are going to be what God has called us to be in the name of Jesus. Sisters are going to pray until they bring forth in the name of Jesus. Brothers are going to pray for the protection in the name of Jesus. We're going to preach in the name of Jesus. We're going to worship in the name of Jesus. We're going to baptize in the name of Jesus. Oh, come on, somebody. Hallelujah. We got the name sense. Now it's time for us to use it in the fight, and we're going to see victory in the name of Jesus.
Woo!
So how do you know? Because every Sunday, since we moved into this place, I have seen Dwayne Shoecraft sitting by his mom. That's how. That's how, Sister Donna. Because we prayed. Sister Donna prayed, and I prayed. I told him the other day, I've been praying for you for a year and a half. Hallelujah, that God would bring you into this church. And look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. I look back here and see Sister Opal's family. I see Sister Dot. I see Tommy. I see Addison. I see Thomas. I see Rose. I see Larry. I see Andrew, his buddy. I see Lily and her children. And I say, that's how I know. Are you hearing what I said, Church of God? Hallelujah, that's That's how I know. Don't tell me what God can do. That's how I know. I know he ain't been here today, but I saw Josh Bowman in here all day last Sunday and Wednesday night. That's how I know. I see Veronica in here. That's how I know. God is up to something, saints. And it's time for us to get the job done. It's time for us to put our face like a flint, put our shoulder in the plow, and push forward. It is the time. It is the season. It is our turn. I'm telling you. I watched Michelle come down here today and get prayed for because she's having a procedure on Tuesday. She came up to me at the door and said, I'm having a medical procedure on Tuesday. I said, this out here. She said, please pray for me. We wouldn't have heard that 2 years ago. We wouldn't have heard that when you all came in. But look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. This is where we are. That's where we're going. So don't buckle your seatbelt.
Stay loose.
We don't need you confined. We need you set free.
Yes.
Amen. Somebody said, what happened if we wreck? We ain't going to. And if we did, the Lord is our protection anyways. Hallelujah. Y'all ready for it? Ain't no seatbelt laws in this kingdom, is there? No, sir. I'm ready for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and tell them, I'm ready for it. I'm ready for it. We are seeing the manifestation. Say, see, you realize some of you may be sitting here saying, my God, we prayed for years now. Look around you at the manifestation of what we've been praying for. There are things that God is doing right now that we've been praying for because we are on the right track, in the right path, and we're headed to the right future. I thank God for this place. I'm not talking about just this building. I do thank God for this building. But I thank God for the moment we're in. I thank God for the place we're in. I thank God for what's happening. So that's where we're headed. And I'm looking forward to the journey. How many of y'all are looking forward to the journey? Woo! Looking forward to the journey. We've not seen the half, saints of God. If you could see what I see, I hope I painted, I'm trying to paint a clearer picture, but if you could see what I see, if you could see the foyer that this sanctuary will eventually become, if you could see what I see, if you could see the hundreds that will be coming into this church, even to the thousands, because there will be a place where hope can be found. Because there ain't no hope in a place where there's no change. There may be excitement, but there's no hope. There may be some type of levity, but there's no hope. But you come into a place, you'll cry bitter tears with hope. You will. You'll weep, but you'll have hope. You'll hurt, but you'll have hope. Because there's hope when I'm changing. I can't keep going. I gotta get out of here. My God, I feel the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, something is happening in this place. Something is taking place. I feel it in the atmosphere, saints. There is something happening in the atmosphere of this church. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. I just feel promise in here. I feel hope in here. I feel joy in here. There's something going on, saints. There's something going on. And we just need to ride. We just need to ride.
Yes.
We just need to ride. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're going to get off. Praise God. Jesus. I think Brother Brian was trying to preach, and he just has to do that Wednesday night. Ties off. Everything that's helping this work of God go forward. Again, if you're one of those that don't come in with cash and you're always like, ah, man, I would give, but I don't have cash. But we got something for you. Amen. Got an app that you can give. How's it pronounced, Michelle? I think I've been pronouncing it correctly. Givelify. I said lifey. Lifey. Givelify. I'd like to know where the Lafi comes from. But Givelify. You can download it on your phone. Some of you have already given on it. It's a really easy app. And what's crazy about it is it's so quick. It's so quick. Just hit this, hit that number, boom, you're done. But you can download it on your phone. If you have Android, you can go to your Google Play Store. And if you have iPhone, you can go to your App Store. And you can download Givelify. And you can hit the button and give to the Lord. If you're watching over live stream, maybe some of you all couldn't be here today. Listen, just because you can't be here doesn't mean you can't give your tithes anymore. I'm telling you, God has made a way for you. This is wonderful. I praise God that God has given. You know, because sometimes, well, you know, I couldn't be there. I'll give next time. You don't have to wait till next time. Just go to your phone. Pull up your Google Play Store, your iPhone App Store, and download Give, Givelify, Givelify. And then you can give right now, even as we're taking. How awesome is that? That they can watch live stream and give. Maybe some of you all that are watching us, you use this for your church. You can give your tithes. All you have to do is when you pull up the Givelify, is you pull up our church, New Destiny Ministry Center, you put in the zip code of 37660, and then it will pull us up. You can select our church, and guess what? My picture and my name is on it just so we don't get confused as to who we're giving to. It's wonderful. But you're not giving to me. Sister Cheryl, it's not coming into my bank account, right? This will go to the church's bank account, so don't worry about that. But if you want to partner with us, if you want to help us and get taking this ministry forward all over the country, whether you're in Africa, whether you're in India, wherever you are, all you have to do is download that app, pull that up, and then you can give to this church. Amen. Wouldn't it be awesome if God would raise up thousands of people, even if it was $5 or $10 a month, that would give to support this work? How incredible would that be? If you want to partner with us on that level, hey, more power to you. Praise God. We have a lot of work to do. We've got school. We've got outreach. I've got international ministry. I've got national ministry. We got all kinds of stuff we need to do. If you want to help us, all you have to do is download the Givelify, Givelify. So, Shabri, can you type that in there for them? And then pull up our church, and you'll be able to give to us. How wonderful is that? So we're going to take up an offering in this house. But we're also going to take up an offering over live stream. While we're taking up our offering right now, you can give with us.
Amen.
The wonders of technology.
Amen.
Amen. So if you're ready to give your tithes and your offerings, everything that helps this work of God, listen, we're going through a little financial hump right here because of all the moving and the expenses that come with that. I did not realize how much that would be. And me and Sister Cheryl just sit there and smile and shake our heads because we cannot figure out how we came up with the money to pay the bills that we pay. Like, it doesn't make any sense, does it? It is a miracle. You're talking about increasing the loaves and fishes. Somehow, God made a way. It's a miracle, Saint. I'm telling you, it is a miracle. But once we get over this church, the financial future of this church is going to look real, real good. And you know what? God brought us into such a place where we don't have such a high mortgage and high payments that we're under, that's what we focus on paying. But we can pour into the ministries that God has given to us. Brother Joe's got prison ministry, which now is our ministry. It is the ministry of this church. So we've got so many things that we need to support. Again, here locally, you want to give? Over live stream, you can give to help support this work of God. You know, I would hope that Africa would. Because I have poured some labor into Africa. I hope that Africa would pour some help back. Amen? Praise God. And they watch our videos too, Saints. I mean, by the hundreds. So let's give as the Lord has given to us. Let's bless the Lord with our offerings. Because we don't want to take it. We want you to give it joyfully. Amen? So Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much that you have given us this wonderful opportunity to worship you in our giving. Bless those that have to give tonight, whether they're in this building or they're watching over live stream. Bless them abundantly, God, as you watch over your word to perform it concerning them. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. All right, stand to your feet, saints. Brother Brooks, come forward. Amen. I've only mentioned his name one time tonight. Praise God. He'll receive this. St. Louis, Missouri, that Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and I'll be heading back Saturday afternoon. I'll be flying back home to be in the Sunday service. We're going to be in ministers meeting there in St. Louis, so that Sunday we'll have our leadership meeting and luncheon. I'm looking forward to that. October the 5th, we are going to have a singing on the grounds. I wouldn't mind to have, like a chili cook-off or something. I don't know, maybe maybe y'all don't want it. I don't know. I could eat chili. It's going to be October, y'all. I could eat some chili.
We could make some money that way.
We could make some money. Amen. Look at Sister. I like Sister Carol. She's called to the ministry. I mean, she just went right to the money. What's that?
Youth on the 21st.
Yes. We're going to have youth on the 21st. For those of you watching over live stream, I know that several could not be here today. Transformed is going to have their youth meeting September the 21st. That is a Saturday from 1 to 4. Normally they have it on Friday nights, but I know that a lot of people are involved in sports and athletics and different things like that, that we would want to invite friends. So I think Saturday is a great time to do it, because you can be outside, you all can have all kinds of fun. So Saturday, September the 21st, from 1 to 4 p.m., we are going to have youth ministry, Transform Youth Ministry. So let's be thinking about that. As parents, our dedication service is November 1st and 2nd, Atlanta, November 7th, 8th, and 9th. If you want to go, just let me know, and we'll look forward to that. We've got our prayer list. We've mentioned those today. Again, if you want, Simona also posts the prayer list and announcements after services, so on Facebook.
You had Barbie call me before I came to church. She had a chest pain.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yes,
that was good.
She said two episodes. Yeah. I told her if it happened to get you.
Yeah, let's pray for Barbie. Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. So pray for her. Of course, laborers, Brother Tom, Tommy and Margaret, Brother Al and Sister Donna, Sister Annette McDonald, Sister Doc, Mike Worley, Sister Cheryl's friend has an unspoken, I think I said Shirley today, Cheryl's friend has an unspoken prayer request. You know, I can't read, y'all. I get everything backwards. Shannon, Tommy, Rachel, and family. I really can't read. I'm just playing. I talked about barely passing high school the other day, and Shauna has not let me forget it. She's like, my God, you're teaching people's children. And you're talking about you barely passed high school? What kind of confidence does that instill? It ought to instill great confidence in you that I could barely pass high school and teach your children so well. The Lord must be involved in that. Praise God. See, my wife, I'm telling you, she's going to put me in a kingdom. First resurrection. If there is such a thing as 144,000 bride members, I am pretty sure I am assured for that position. I better be careful. People think I make fun of her, put her in closets, beat on her. Dear God, damn it. Hey, no woman would talk to their husband like that that got put in a closet. People are so stupid. It's the most ridiculous thing. Sister Virginia. See, you overcome when you can laugh about it. Sister Virginia, Maya Barbie, of course, Solomon and Gavin, Sister Betty Randolph, and Sister Barbara. Now, we're going to pray for these. But before we do, there's a special lady in this house got a birthday tomorrow. And she ain't going to be in church tomorrow for us to sing happy birthday to. So Mimi has got a birthday tomorrow.
Aww. It's Tuesday.
Is it Tuesday? I thought it was tomorrow. Well, nevertheless,
right.
She will not be here
right.
In service. So we're going to sing happy birthday to her.
Yeah, I need it right now.
I know.
Happy birthday.
I know. So y'all.
87 years old.
87 years old. Amen. The Lord has granted her a long life.
Right.
Amen. But she has served God with that long life too. All right, and by the way, it was almost 27 years ago, 26 years ago, that she had her heart attack, almost took her out. She had a quadruple bypass, is that right? And so all these years later, she has made it by the grace of God.
I told those doctors I'm not coming back again. They said, oh, yes, you will. Here I am. I wonder what the stomach.
Oh, they can't see us, Mimi. Can you come out? I'll help you.
Don't let me fall.
No. I won't.
I have a fear of falling.
Me too. This way. This way. This way. This way. Is that better? She's short, y'all. Can you see us?
No.
All right. So we're going to sing happy birthday to her. And then we're going to get traditional and then religious. You don't mind that. that, right?
Not at all.
All right, y'all ready? One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Minnie. Happy birthday to you.
Are y'all ready? Oh, happy birthday to you.
Oh, happy birthday to you. May you find Jesus dear every day of the year. Oh, happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. And the best one you've ever
had. Amen.
I'm 87 years old almost, and I tell you, a lot of things have changed.
Praise God.
I used to walk all over the place. Now I just walk.
All right. Well, praise the Lord. All right, Brother Brian, come and dismiss us in a word of prayer.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad he's in church tonight? I don't know about you, but I wouldn't miss this for nothing. All y'all in the Sunday morning only folks, you're missing something. And the live stream is all right, but they don't hold a candle to be in the house. Amen. Because God's glory was here. His power was here. All that Lord born was here. Lives were changed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'm so glad to be a part of the church. I'm so glad that all God's doing in our midst. Amen. Every testimony. Hallelujah. Every song was anointed. It just blessed my soul.
Lord.
Glory to God. How great is our God. Amen. Amen. God's doing such great and awesome things. In us, to us, and through us, and I'm just glad to be a part of it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Brother Ken, I saw you singing in the microphone. Did you want to sing a solo before we go home? All right. But we do thank God for all he's doing. Amen.
Amen.
And we did receive our marching orders.
Yes.
Amen, church.
Yes.
And all the women of Zion are to get into their birthing position,
right,
which is on your knees in prayer to pray for this generation.
Yes.
Why? Because he's called us to this generation.
Yes.
And for us men is to pray for protection.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Over the women.
Yes.
Amen. We've got to fight for our wives.
Right.
We've got to fight, come on, for our spouses,
yes,
for our children,
yes,
and for our grandchildren. Why? Because God's called us to do it. He's anointed us to do it. And he's empowered us to do it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Through God we shall do valiantly. Amen. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Let's close out in a word of prayer. Amen. Father, we thank you, O God, Lord, for this day in your house, O God. We thank you, Lord, for the word. God, we thank you for the spirit, Lord, how you've touched your people, O God. Lord, we ask you, O God, as we go from this place, you'd watch over every family, God, every person, Father. In the name of Jesus, Lord, those who wasn't here today, O Father, that you would bring them back, Father. Oh, God, we ask you to touch Barbie, oh, God. Lord, you know the situation, oh, God. Touch her breathing, oh, God. Touch her lungs. Heal, oh, God. Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, we thank you for Sister Betty being here, but God, continue to help her. God, touch Brother Al, Father, in the name of Jesus. Oh, Sister Annette. Oh, God, be with Tommy and Rachel in that situation, oh, Father. Continue to make a way, oh, Father. Oh, be with all of your people, oh, God. Help us to do your will. Show us the way, oh, God, and we'll walk in it. We'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. Until we come back next time, be with us, oh, Father. Help us to do your will, God, and to lift up your name in the midst of this crooked and perverse nation. And all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.